everyone to this really exciting National Palliative Care Week event here in Victoria. And I'd like to introduce you to one of the key people who are on the stage today, Rhonda Gulbally AO, who really needs no introduction. Dr. Rhonda Gulbally, as you know, has devoted her life to promoting equity and justice in Australia. She's been a CEO for over 25 years, and she's founded and led a number of world-leading organisations, such as the Victorian Health Promotion Foundation, the Australian Commission for the Future, and recently Our Community. Some of her many current roles include Chair of the National People with Disabilities and Carers Council, Chair of the Royal Melbourne Women's Hospital. She's a member of the National Disability Insurance Scheme Advisory Group, which has really made some quite significant achievements. And she's also chair of the International Board of Evaluation for the Thai Health Promotion Foundation. She holds a number of other positions and patronage, and she's a patron of many organisations, but relevant to us today is she's patron of the Compassionate Friends of Victoria. And it's my great pleasure to hand over to Rhonda to really host and MC this event with Dr. Ira Byock. Enjoy, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much, Odette, and it's lovely to be here.
Thank
and
you.
I'm going to introduce Ira more fully towards the end of my comments. But I'm here in part today because I really hope to die well. It's one of my aims, actually, in living, that I hope to die well. And dying well for me means that I'd like someone to be there holding me, calmly helping me on my way, and I hope that someone or someones aren't fearful and terrified of dying. I'd like to die pain-free. I'd like to die terror-free. I'd like to be in a familiar place. I'd like to be able to bear to let go because I'm not so frightened. And of course, I'd like to have loved ones around me if possible. And I'd like to die well because I believe it's a last bequest to my friends and my family who will also at some stage be facing death. And I want them to also be able to die well, learning in part from me dying well, because I think it goes intergenerationally. But how am I likely to die in Australia now? Well, I'm likely to be untouched, because I'll be untouchable because of other people's fear of me dying. I'm likely to be excluded from the community in an unfamiliar place, in a nursing home or a hospital. I might even die in an apartment. I'm left there for a couple of weeks because nobody knows I exist, because I'm so isolated. I can't even count on being pain-free in Australia at the moment. So today we share a really important conversation, I believe, because it's an opportunity for us, a very rare opportunity actually, for us all to talk about dying. One of the really no-go areas still of conversation in Australian society. Today is very important because when a subject like dying is excluded from the public consciousness, it of course goes deep into our unconscious and it takes on a life of its own. And when the topic of dying is repressed, then dying and death become part of the terror of nightmares. And when death is not part of the community, and in Australia, we certainly don't lay out the body in the lounge room where the children come and say goodbye, you know, which is the case in some countries. Then the dying are avoided, isolated, and even repulsed rather than lovingly being supported, which includes communicated with about dying. So as I've said before, mainly with palliative care organisations, I believe it's time that death and dying are brought out of the shadows and into the light. I think it's time we talked about death as part of ordinary life. And we were talking earlier and saying that it is true that the more you talk and think about dying, the better you live.
Right.
You know, it's just that paradox about dying. So it's with enormous pleasure that I congratulate Odette and Palliative Care Victoria for organising this opportunity. I think it's just so great that you've done that. And I thank Ultra Feedback for their generous support. And I now turn to introducing Ira. Can I call you Ira?
Please
do. Is that okay?
Please
do. I've got Dr. Byock all the way through, but I think you're an Ira.
Very, very much.
Is a world leader in hospice and palliative care. And I'm going to go, I know it's excruciating for you.
A little.
But I'm going to go through the detailed bio, because I do think you should know who we have here properly. So Ira is Director of Palliative Medicine at Dartmouth Hitchcock Medical Centre in Lebanon, New Hampshire, and a professor at the Geisel School of Medicine at Dartmouth. Ira has been involved in hospice and palliative care since 1978 during his residency, which also included emergency medicine even way back, but he can fill you in on that. He helped found a hospice home care program for the poor population served by the University Hospital and County Clinics of Fresno, California. Ira is a past president in 1997 of the American Academy of Hospice and Palliative Medicine. And during the 90s, Ira was a co-founder and principal investigator for the Missoula Demonstration Project, a community-based organization in Montana dedicated to the research and transformation of end-of-life experience locally as a demonstration of what is possible nationally. From 1996 through to 2006, he served as Director of Promoting Excellence in End-of-Life Care, which was a national grant program of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Ira has authored numerous articles on the ethics and practice of hospice, palliative, and end-of-life care. His first book, Dying Well, in 1997, has become a standard in the field. The Four Things That Matter Most, 2004, is widely used as a counselling tool by palliative care and hospice programs, as well as within pastoral care. And his most recent book, The Best Care Possible, which you can get on Amazon, but apparently not in Australia yet, March 2012, tackles the crisis that surrounds serious illness and dying in America and his quest to transform care through the end of life. It has been praised by the Wall Street Journal and recognised by Politico as a key issue book for the 2012 presidential campaign. So really getting the topic onto the political agenda. Ira has been a consistent advocate for the voice and rights of dying patients and their families. He's been the recipient of numerous awards. I won't read all of these
out
because I'm going to get on to hearing about him. And so without more ado, I'm just delighted to be here with you, Ira, hear from you.
Thank you very much.
Thank
I'm going to go to the podium if that's okay. Thank you. Thank you all so very much for being here. I'm deeply moved to see this wonderful space filled with people who on a Monday afternoon would come out and see this pushy American. Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. I want to thank Odette Wanders and Palliative Care Victoria for organizing this remarkable event and for all of you for being here. So I want to talk about a number of things today. I want to probably start with a few quick disclaimers. I often cannot live up to my introductions. In fact, sometimes I have the awkward situation of being introduced as an expert in death and dying. Just think how odd that sounds to me. So I want to be very clear to begin with that I have never died. That I know of. And I've never even had a life-threatening illness, at least that I know of. Feel pretty good, but this could be the start of something serious, I guess. I am, however, like probably so many of you, a serious student of this experience and time of life we call dying. I hang out with people who are seriously ill and facing the end of life on a regular basis. I'm a practicing physician, busy practicing physician. And for over 30 years, nearly 35 years, in approaching people who are seriously ill, I've often asked them to explain to me, to help me understand what the world looks like through their eyes, so that I can be a better physician to them, but also, frankly, a better teacher. The other disclaimer I want to make very clear is that while we titled this talk saying the four things that matter most, which is very close to the title of this book, The Four Things That Matter Most, I am really and truly not here to sell this book. Now, in fact, you know that because Palliative Care Victoria has been nice enough to give you all a book. But authors, you know, write books and then they go on tour to sell their books, and that's entirely legitimate. In my situation, in this circumstance, it would be more accurate to say that I wrote this book to give this talk. Because I realized long ago that if you have something you really want to say into the culture, and I think a lot about speaking into the culture and really engaging the culture in thinking about these issues, if you have something serious that you want to say into the culture, you darn well better write a book. Because if you don't write a book, nobody calls you and for interviews. They don't invite you over to their country to give talks. And so it really is more accurate to say that I wrote this book to give this talk. And in fact, in so many ways, having heard this talk in a little bit, you really hardly need to read the book. Not that I want you to read the book, and I'd love it if people gave it to others and, you know, copies were sold, that would be fine. But in many ways, it would be enough to be able to say, you know, I heard this guy once give this talk, and he says, and then starting from there. Or I was just on John Fain's show with Beth Wilson and Nisha Fitzgerald, and it would be enough to say, you know, I heard this guy interviewed on the radio, and he was talking about the four things that matter most. That's well enough. It allows you to begin a conversation that we all, frankly, would be benefited by having. The reason that I'm here is that we have, in our culture, a lot to learn from mortality. You know, mortality will teach us a lot about life, if we let it. But of course, few of us are willing to let it. In fact, most of us, most of the general culture, avoids mortality sort of at all costs. Many of you, however, are different. May I ask, how many folks in the audience are in some way involved in a palliative care or hospice program? Isn't that lovely? Thank you very much for doing it. So from my sense, so many of you culturally are like firemen. What I mean is that while most people in our culture are running as fast as they can away from anything having to do with illness, caregiving, dying, death, and grief, you folks walk in. And for that alone, you have earned my lasting, deeply felt respect. In fact, we learn a lot in the work that we do that people in the general culture could not even imagine. Where one would expect to find only suffering, even misery, well, it's often there. But we also find moments of profound meaning around people who are seriously ill, people facing the end of life. Where we would expect, and the culture would predict, that we would find only tragedy and sorrow, they're there. But we also occasionally find joy. Where we would expect the most somber of moods and solemnity, we find them, but also we commonly witness a sense of celebration, even at times laughter. Within these experiences that are sort of countercultural or counter to our expectations, there is this remarkable wisdom that, frankly, could teach our culture so much. In fact, we know a lot more about suffering than many of the people in our culture. And that alone gives us much to teach. Now, there's a lot of suffering in the world. Just think of it. Famines, floods, earthquakes, tsunamis, droughts, wars. Many of it, much of the suffering that we read about and witness is way beyond our capacity to touch. But for my many years of work in emergency medicine, which I did for almost 14 years, and certainly in palliative care, I've learned from that window into the intimate experiences of other people that the clinical work offers us, that many people are suffering in sort of mundane, arcane, everyday ways. I mean, just look at the market for antidepressants in both of our countries. We spend billions and billions, I kind of sound like Carl Sagan, billions and billions and billions treating depression. You know, in America, we talk about ourselves as the Prozac nation. Do you know what Prozac is? It's called something else here, I think, but fluoxetine. There's a lot of it being sold. In my work, I've come to consider the four things that matter most to be a form of an antidote or prevention for the mundane suffering that so many people feel. Now, the four things that matter most, of course, aren't things at all. They're just 11 words. Please forgive me. I forgive you. Thank you. I love you. Many of us in this field have been using statements like this for many years in our clinical work. I've simply named them and have tried to, you know, promulgate them. We know that well-chosen words can often be catalysts for healing, for health, for wholeness. And that's useful. The four things that matter most can represent a proactive approach to mending and tending relationships that really are the things that matter most. They are not only powerful clinical tools, but they're often tools for self-care, for emotional well-being. And that's needed in this world. For in the society in which I live, the culture of America, nobody teaches us, at least in secular culture, nobody teaches us about emotional self-care. Instead, in America, we're all about peak physical health, well-being. Our culture is fascinated by health defined as physical health. We don't smoke. We check our breasts and our testicles for lumps. We submit to pelvic exams and rectal exams and colonoscopies. We know our cholesterol numbers. All of us do. We know exactly how much fat we eat every day in our diets and exactly what types. We eat fiber until flatulence stresses our relationships and threatens us with social embarrassment. We jog and we swim and we bicycle long distances. We buy health club memberships and treadmills and Bowflex machines. I actually know a few people who use them, mostly to hang things on. But. And we wear seat belts and we wear bicycle helmets and, of course, we floss. But when it comes to maintaining our emotional well-being, our emotional health, the health of our relationships, we don't have any similar, easy, practical tools to use, habits to cultivate. I know, so many of you know, that well-chosen words can be these tools, these powerful catalysts. From the work that I've done, so many of us have done, with people forced to face the fact that time is short, I've learned that saying these four things, basically expressing forgiveness, asking for forgiveness, expressing gratitude and love, can be the most important things we can do for our emotional health, for ourselves and our families' emotional well-being. They seem at least as important as flossing. Now, part of that wisdom has to do with forgiveness of others, which I want to talk a bit about this afternoon. But I know that in forgiving others, often the most important relationship, the most difficult relationship we have in our lives to bring forgiveness to is our relationship with ourselves. We tend to be hard on ourselves. If someone doesn't feel worthy of forgiveness themselves, it's very hard for them to forgive others or to engage in the sort of mending and tending of relationships that really, you know, leads to healing and wholeness. We often feel embarrassed about ourselves and unworthy, and that makes it hard to reach out to others. What makes us unworthy? Well, I know because of the work that I do and the intimate access it gives me to people's perspectives on their own or on their own personhood. Many people carry wounds that are, again, mundane. They're so common, and yet they can hurt. Wounds like, I never lived up to my mother or father's expectations. I was never tall enough or pretty enough or good enough at music or sports or school or business. We may blame ourselves for never having followed or achieved or fulfilled a lifelong dream that for whatever reason remained out of our reach. Here's one piece of wisdom that I've learned from the work that I've done with people who are seriously ill and facing the end of life. This is one you may want to write down. Call it lesson one. Human beings are imperfect. We all strive for perfection, but the fact is that if you are like so many of the people that I've had the privilege of caring for and sitting with through the very end of life, it's likely you will die imperfect. Here's my suggestion. You may want to write this down too. Get over it. Because in fact, you're just human. We all are. And, you know, that's good enough. We're not called to be perfect. We're just human. We can strive for perfection. It's just essential that we don't beat ourselves up for being human, because it's a good thing to be. But many people are needlessly hard on themselves. You know, so many of us grew up as human doings rather than human beings, right? I did. I'm an adult child of Jewish parents. It's a condition that has no known cure. You can find it, in fact, I happen to see a new edition of the DSM-5 coming out. And it's listed in the DSM-5, right under adult children of Catholic parents. I grew up in a loving household. I was told all the time I was a good boy. But it kind of had a half-life. You know, you had to kind of re-up it from time to time, recharge it. For me, it was getting good grades, cleaning my room, sweeping the floor after dinner every night without being asked, right? Writing thank you notes to my aunts and uncles and relatives after they gave me gifts, birthday gifts or holiday gifts. But in fact, we are good people. Yet when I sit with people facing the end of life, often there's this sense that they feel unworthy. You know, I've developed some counseling and diagnostic tools that I use in helping to support people. In sitting with them, if I have the sense of that people are unworthy, sometimes I will just ask them in private, can you just repeat after me the phrase, I am not a bad person? Can you do that? Sometimes people look at me and then they look down and to their left, I couldn't do that, doctor. Why not? We're alone here. You can tell me, who have you killed this week? You know? What is it? Everybody who knows you says you're such a loving person. Oh, she'd give you the shirt off her back. She'll do anything for people. And yet you don't feel worthy? What is it? Oh, I bet I know. It's the smoking, isn't it? You know how many people come to the end of life these days feeling bad about themselves because they do or once did smoke? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm all for smoking cessation and getting rid of the scourge of tobacco on the health of our countries. But nobody in our zeal to stop, you know, people from smoking wanted to inflict them with guilt during the end of life. So I sit with people and I just let them know that, you know, I wish you'd never smoked. I wish you'd still stop smoking, but that doesn't make you a bad person. You're a good person. You know, in fact, I've begun to teach people to be able to say, you know, I want you to go home, and I want, as you sit at night or lying in bed in the privacy of your thoughts, I want you to work with the phrase, I am not a bad person. I start there with the negative, just so I can ease into it. And I teach them almost like a meditative technique. You know, imagine a big wheel, like a roulette wheel, and around the edge of the wheel is written, I am not a bad person. And just say that to yourself. And your mind will play lots of tricks on you, will bring up all the things that you're ashamed of, all the things that you regret, all the things that you, you know, are just as happy that other people don't know or have forgotten. We all have them. We're all human. So as they come and go, just come back to that phrase, I am not a bad person. I am not a bad person. And I want you to practice that. It's better than counting sheep, for heaven's sakes. Just practice that. I want to cultivate in you the capacity to feel worthy. And as you work on this, we'll see each other in a week or so. And if you're able to do this, of course, you know I'm going to change the writing on the outside of the wheel. I want you to be able to use that same technique and be able to say, I am a good person. I am a good person. I am a good person. And just work with the different emphasis and cadence and begin to accept yourself for being a good person, not perfect, but loving, well-intentioned, generous. Mortality will teach us a lot about life. It teaches us to have mercy for others, but also mercy for ourselves. Lesson number 2. You may want to write this one down, too. The things that matter most to people aren't things at all. They're other people. You know, ask somebody being wheeled into transplant surgery or someone facing cancer chemotherapy for the 3rd or 4th or 5th time, what matters most now? The answers will always include the names of people they love. I don't care what their age is, what their language is, what their diagnosis is, what their gender is, the color of their skin, their religion. It doesn't matter. This one is a constant that cuts across culture, that is part of being human. In fact, the things that fill our calendars are, you know, iPads and iCals and daily plans fall away pretty quickly when you or someone you love is seriously ill. It is a fact of being human that our connections with other human beings, other people, are the primal source of meaning, a potential source of enormous gratification, and of course, a potential source of enormous, deep emotional pain. In fact, lesson number 3 is that because human beings are imperfect, relationships tend to be imperfect. You don't have to be Sigmund Freud or Carl Jung or Fraser Crane. Do you know Fraser Crane? To realize that, you know, many people suffer from the common mundane wounds that erode the quality of their relationships and their self-images and the quality of their lives. Most of us carry some of these, if you think back to your childhood, which for many of us wasn't perfect either. Most of those emotional, mundane sorts of scrapes and bruises that we sustain eventually heal. Perhaps it was a callous remark by a, you know, uncle or your mom or a coach or a teacher or a close friend. We get over it. You know, life is long, and thankfully we get over it. But some of the sore spots from our youth only close for a while, or the scab is thin. And later, sometimes years later, another callous remark, sometimes by the same person or sometimes by another, that sort of reminds us of the wounds from our youth, kind of picks the scab and reminds us of the hurts that we still carry. Of course, there are deeper wounds that many of us have sustained, wounds from lies or infidelities, painful divorces, libels or lawsuits. Those open all too easily. And then we know in a room this size, there will be many people, at least several people, who carry deep wounds carved by physical, emotional, or even sexual abuse, usually perpetrated by people they trusted. They may never close. Here again, mortality can teach us a lot. For if it wasn't for mortality, there would be no urgency to deal with any of these wounds, any of these transgressions. Because for one thing, if we were immortal, there'd always be another chance. You know, you might see your uncle who was mean or even abusive to you at some point in the past and think, boy, I gotta talk to that son of a gun sometime. But not today, because I'm kind of busy and I gotta go. There'd always be another chance. But in fact, the fact is we live every minute of every day just a heartbeat away from eternity, from our death. And so does everyone else we know and love or once loved. In fact, what I've learned is that healing is possible. Call that lesson number 4. Now, I know that must sound outrageous. In fact, particularly to people who are in clinical training or clinical, you know, work, the academics, saying that healing is possible can sound sort of new agey or like pop psychology. In fact, I'm a somewhat skeptical person myself, and I know it must sound preposterous. Cynicism is in vogue. And I realize the assertion that, you know, you can say 4 things and heal relationships must seem ridiculous. It's an overreach. Fair enough. But in fact, my experience in being with so many ill people who are and families who are forced to face the fact that time is short has taught me that so often it is possible for relationships to heal, even those that I personally would have thought were way beyond hope. Let me put this a different way. As a clinician, I have learned that I must suspend my disbelief about the possibility of a fractured relationship healing in order to be of some help as a counselor. Because believing that healing is impossible tends to be self-fulfilling. It's the basis for therapeutic nihilism. Why even bother? Why go there? This is never going to work, Ira. This fractured relationship may mean the father was abusive, after all, to both his son and his daughter. This is never going to heal. Leave it alone. And that may be useful counseling in some regards, but I've been surprised more than a few times where I thought it wouldn't be possible or would take years on the couch for a relationship to heal, and somehow they got it together. Boy, that really expands my ability to imagine that healing is possible. If it wasn't for the work that I do and have done again and again, I would have been surprised. So I know I need to suspend my disbelief. Because if you believe something's impossible, why even go there? In fact, as a counselor, I have to be conscious of the potential constraints of my own ability to imagine what's possible for others. When this book first came out, I was doing this, you know, satellite interview, they call it. You don't go on book tours anymore unless you're really famous, not like just Palliative Care famous, you know. But what the publisher did was they buy a series of PR, public relations packages, and that includes these satellite radio interviews. So you sit in your office and you do these, you know, 10, 15 minute drive time radio interviews, right? And it marches from our country east to west, so you're catching in various time zones, you're catching people in drive time, usually behind a wheel in traffic somewhere, okay? And one of these, that I think we were doing an interview, I was in my office at the university at Dartmouth, and I think we were live on radio. I know we were live on radio. I think it was in Philadelphia. And the radio interviewer said to me, Dr. Byock, I read your book, and it was really good. He really said that. But then he said, but why would anybody buy it? I mean, you give it away in the first 11 words. And in fact, the book opens, please forgive me, I forgive you, thank you, I love you. I thought that was a great question, and I thought to myself, I flashed on all of these people who I imagined in traffic, sort of stuck behind a wheel in downtown Philadelphia, and I thought, well, good question. And I said, because if I didn't tell stories, it would be utterly preposterous. Who would believe that healing is possible by saying 11 words? It's the stories that matter. Stories, hopefully, will resonate with some of our listeners. And I've told hard stories. These are, I didn't pick the easiest stories or the most, healthy relationships to tell. There's not much drama in that anyway, but it's not very instructional. I picked hard stories in which somehow healing happened so that they would resonate with our readers or our listeners. And my hope is that in reading those stories, people will get a sense, well, it happened to them, and, you know, that's somewhat similar to relationships in my own life. Maybe it can help us stretch the realm of what we consider to be possible. And in doing so, allow us to at least approach this our fractured relationships and in some way catalyze some healing and collectively catalyze some cultural change. My answer to why bother is that the last chapter or chapters of a story of a fractured relationship is still to be written. And the story of a fractured relationship that ends well actually transforms all that has preceded. It becomes a prelude to a healthy ending, to a happy ending at times. The most exciting clinical work I've ever done is to help people mend and tend relationships and transform the story of a relationship and often, therefore, the story of a family. Wow. It's the greatest stuff. I've done emergency medicine. I've done, saved lives. I've done trauma resuscitations and, so many exciting clinical work, great clinical work, very fulfilling. But this stuff is remarkable. It's not, Yogi Berra, a famous baseball player and philosopher in the United States, has said, it ain't over till it's over. And I've learned that there's almost always a next chapter to be written, even if it's only a few paragraphs long. It's not easy, it takes courage, and often some skillful guidance, but often it's possible, even when you thought it might not be. Now, at this point in this little talk, I have to imagine, and I know that it's true because I do lots of talks and Q&As with question and answers with people on the radio calling into talk shows. I know that many of you may well be thinking, yeah, right. Because it still seems a little glib, doesn't it? Almost preposterous. Anger, by the way, if you have a fractured relationship, if somebody has harmed you, from my perspective, you have a right to be angry. Anger is an entirely legitimate emotion. If you've been wronged and you desire to stay angry, frankly, you have my blessing. I just want you to know it's not your only option. It's a choice. It's not my intention to talk you out of it, but there are other options. This notion of forgiveness is often misunderstood. It's often we conflate it with absolving someone of having harmed you or absolving them of the responsibility for their actions. I guess in some circumstances, maybe it encompasses that. But for most of us, healing is nothing of the sort. Other people say, well, forgive and forget. Well, okay, but those aren't the same things. Forgetting is dementia. It's not forgiveness, right? Forgiveness fundamentally isn't about the other person at all. Not primarily, it's about ourselves. It's about the person offering forgiveness. It's not easy, but it is volitional. Asking for forgiveness and forgiving others turns out to be a sophisticated emotional strategy for our own well-being. Lily Tomlin, the comedian, once observed, forgiveness means giving up all hope for a better past. Isn't that brilliant? It involves accepting that the past can't be changed while recognizing that it need not control our future. Forgiveness is actually like emotional economics. You know, it's about taking a one-time cost that you pay up to clear up years of complicated emotional pain. In financial matters, you know, if somebody owes you money or they bought something on time and then never completed their payments, or they borrowed your, you know, chainsaw or you know, your lawnmower and they never gave it back, right? In business, you can take the loss one time and go on with a clear slate. Emotionally, we can do the same thing. It's not about forgetting. If somebody bought something on time from your store and they never paid you back, you can take the loss, but it's unlikely if they come back into the store and want to buy something else on time, you're going to say, no, that's not going to thank you very much, right? You're going to remember that, and it's going to change your behavior in the future. So too, forgiveness doesn't mean forgetting that you've been transgressed or harmed. It just means that you get rid of your emotional baggage. In the book, I tell the story, a real story, although I've changed the names, of a fellow I call Avi. He was a counseling client of Lynn Halamash, that's her real name, a wonderful grief counselor who happens to live in Israel. And she tells the story of her work with Avi, who was an emotionally abused son of a fellow named Simon, who was his father in biology only. Simon had never married Avi's mother. They lived in a town in which Simon was a very prominent man. And Avi came to be involved with Lynn when Simon was seriously ill and dying. Avi's mother realized how much Avi's hatred for his father, his biological father, was eating him alive and really destroying some of his relationships in his own life. She saw patterns repeating. So Avi's mother asked him to please work with Lynn before Simon died, and that's the only reason he did so. With Lynn's strong counseling, Avi recognized that he had wasted enough time allowing his feelings to rule his life. So he made the calculated decision to release himself from the bondage of his hatred towards Simon. With Lynn's help, he recognized that even if his father didn't deserve forgiveness, Avi did. He was going to die, but Avi was going to be left to carry the animosity and resentment for years to come. So what happened was that, you know, in working with Lynn, Lynn said, you got to go to your father, Simon, and you got to say these four things to him. And Avi said, you know, what do I have to forgive him for? He was nasty to me throughout my life. You know, how can I ask him, you know, how can I do this? He says, you have to do it. So he went with counseling, he went to him and said, please forgive me, because apparently I was never the son that you wanted. And I forgive you because apparently you were incapable of giving me love and the sort of support that I needed. And he couldn't hardly say, I love you, but with Lynn's help, he sort of said it as a question, you know, I love you? Because she had told him that we're biologically hardwired to love our parents, which is pretty much true. And he said, thank you at least for giving me life. Well, you know, as many of you will read, in reality, it worked out very well. Simon was, in fact, you know, softened by his illness, and he returned the emotions and was able to say wonderful things, warm things, supportive things to his son. And what happened was that the relationship ended well. And Avi became much more emotionally, you know, well within himself. He realized that, in fact, he had been perpetuating some of these negative emotions that were really displaced animosity toward his father and a sense of unworthiness. And things worked out really well. Well, it's a great story, and it's an instructive story, but it can be fairly asked, what would have happened had Simon simply rolled over to the other side and said, get lost. I never liked you, you're never a worthy kid, and you know. It happens. In fact, I counsel people in broken relationships if they want to have a try at mending or tending this relationship, that they can only take care of their side of any relationship. All of us can only take care of our side of any relationship.
And if these words are said with some expectation that they will be returned, that the emotions will be returned in kind, you're at high risk for being disappointed. You know, they say 90% of life is showing up. What I've learned is the other 10% has to do with arriving with good intentions. Show up, arrive with good intentions. You're likely to be better off for having made the effort. And that's what I counsel, and that's frankly what I've learned from people. Showing up, saying these words in ways that are heartfelt, authentic, but without an expectation that they must be returned in kind. Everyone who I've counseled has ended up feeling better about having made the good faith effort. Now, thankfully, most of us live in relatively normal or only mildly dysfunctional families. I've long thought that phrase, dysfunctional family, was redundant. I don't know about your families, but family life tends to be messy. You know, we don't respect people's boundaries. We get in their face. We say things we would never say to other people. There are misunderstandings, hurt feelings. This is common in relationships, certainly family relationships. As I've explained, even the most loving of human relationships tend to be imperfect. And this is to be expected, and it's okay. But for each person that we love in our lives, it is worth asking if there would be important things left unsaid between us if they or we were to die suddenly, as any of us might. Another radio talk show host, during one of these radio satellite interviews that I did when the book first came out, asked me, he said, Dr. Byock, who was your target audience for writing this book? And I'm thinking about people, you know, traffic. I said, well, I guess I wrote the book for anyone who's mortal. Or if our listeners, if they're not mortal themselves, if you're driving there and you think, well, that doesn't apply to me. If you love someone who's mortal, that's enough to put you at risk. You know, in the United States, 43,000 people die every year from car accidents. Not all of sudden deaths, but just car accidents. 43,000 people a year. Those people didn't leave home that morning thinking I'm dying and what would be left undone. But that day, for each of them, just like that, they lost important opportunities to say the things that now were left unsaid. This is the one audiovisual piece of this presentation. I want to play you a little clip, a little audio clip. It's about 30 seconds long. What you're going to hear is my sister Molly's voice. This clip is from our home answering machine. It occurred in November of 2003, during the eve of the American Thanksgiving. My sister is calling to tell me that our mother, Ruth Byock, was just in a car accident, and she got the call. In fact, on my computer, this little clip is called The Call. You know, it's the call we all dread. Let me just play it, and then I'll see if this goes through.
Ira, it's Molly. I just left the message.
Can you hear that? Not so well. Let me see.
Ira, it's Molly. I just left a message on your cell phone. This is not good, sir. I just got a call. I'm going to the Orange Coast Memorial Medical Center, ER, and Jesse and Gail are going to be meeting me there. Phone number there is 714-378-7535, and my cell phone, 310-291-3112. And I'm going to take some deep breaths and pray that if she's in bad shape, she's gone. And I didn't sound good, I. And I love you, and I'll need all the support in the world, sweetie. Bye-bye.
My mom died that night. She didn't actually have a car accident. She had a heart attack, and she was on the San Diego freeway near L.A. And as far as we can tell, she had a heart attack and then just slumped over and rolled into the car in front of her. It was very heavy traffic, so she wasn't going very fast. I tell you this story and this little clip for several reasons. First is to make the point, we're all in this together. There are no experts here. Ultimately, you know, we're people who love one another and who are at risk for emotional pain of losing the people we love. But I also tell you this because I missed my mom. A lot's happened since 2003. I moved to Dartmouth. She knew I was moving, but you know, a great deal has happened. They made me a full professor, which she would have been extremely proud of. Her two granddaughters, my two daughters, have you know done beautifully well. Now we have a first grandchild, her first great grandchild. She would have just caviled with joy at all of this. And although I'm sad, and frankly I haven't heard this clip in a while, and it's kind of hard to hear, I draw strength and confidence from knowing that there was nothing critically important left unsaid between my mom and me. How can I be so sure? Well, she read the galleys for this book. I had to have the talk, right? I had so much to thank her for. I had, you know, I had forgiveness to ask her for. I made her life crazy when I was growing up as an adolescent, young adult. But I had so much more to thank her for and much love to express to her. And we really had the process, and it was helpful for me, for both of us, because when there's nothing left unsaid, boy, relationships become a little lighter and more joyful. People ask me often, Dr. Byock, how has this work that you done that you do affected your personal life? Well, I'd love to tell you that I'm much more sensitive, that I listen longer, and that I'm patient with people, and I never snap at people. But my wife Yvonne is in the audience. Say hello, Yvonne, please. And she would tell you that that would not be true. I work too hard, I drink too much coffee, I sleep too little at times, and I have kind of a slightly cranky demeanor. It's true. What I have learned during the time that I've done this work, and it gets reinforced regularly, I've learned to apologize more thoroughly, earlier, and deeply than I ever have in my earlier life, and than I think I ever would have had I not done this work. And it turns out that when I've screwed up again, that in apologizing to the person who I've in some way hurt or offended, snapped at, that in doing so, I've learned a remarkable thing happens. In fact, because in apologizing, I have to stand sort of naked, warts showing, and state to the other person that as embarrassed as I am that I've done it again, this relationship means more to me than my sense of embarrassment or shame. It's a recommitment, a reinvestment in the relationship. And what happens when the apology is accepted, and I've been thankful that in apologizing, my apologies have been accepted, that ironically or seemingly paradoxically, the relationship seems stronger for the process. Not that I am happy that I screwed up again and snapped or angered somebody, but that reinvestment has somehow strengthened the relationship. And that, in and of itself, is worth all the work that I've done. Mortality can teach us a lot about life, even about parenting. Since writing this book, I met a woman I'll call Joyce, 67-year-old woman living with the last stages of metastatic breast cancer. I met her in the hospital at Dartmouth and did a palliative care consult. And I, you know, in taking a social history and her family history, she talked to me about her son and her daughter, both in their 30s. And she said, they're just struggling to find themselves, Dr. Byock. She talked to me about her daughter, who was a very successful attorney doing international work. But she said, you know, she's just not found herself, Dr. Byock. She's, you know, she's seeing this shrink in Boston. $200 an hour, she rolled her eyes. Twice a week. We talked about, you know, completing relationships, and I got around to talking about the four things. And, you know, we got through please forgive me and I forgive you and talked about, you know, I love you, and she acknowledged that she loved both of her children very much. And then I suggested that, you know, it might be worth her considering saying to each of her children, her son and her daughter separately, just how proud she was of them. I said, I don't want you to lie, but I'm sure there are things that you're proud of. I can hear it in your voice. At that point, you know, she was nodding with me as I, you know, and kind of following the conversation as I was talking about the four things. And when we got to saying, you know, it would be wonderful, what a gift for them to hear from their mother that you're proud of them, that you're proud to be their mother. And at that point, she started to tear up. Now, in palliative care, we, you know, teach people to just be present, right? And just be there and let it unfold. So I was just practicing being present. I was breathing and just letting, you know, and she was, got, you know, her eyes welled up, and I was just being there. And then she started to giggle. And that got me, my curiosity got the best of me. And I said, Joyce, why are you laughing? And she said, well, that's what my daughter needs, Dr. Byock. She doesn't need that shrink. Are you kidding? She needs me, her mother, to tell her how proud I am of her, how much I love her, how proud I am to be her mother. And then we both started laughing, and I said, you know, boy, if all of us who are parents would take the time and invest the emotional energy to tell each of our children how much we love them and how proud we are to be their parents, we could retire boatloads of psychotherapists. I mean, they'd be hungry. Because a lot of people spend a lot of time on the couch getting over this one, right? In fact, I've met so many children, adult children, sometimes tearful, sometimes crying in my arms after a mother or father has died because they've never heard those words. And some of those children were in their 60s. This doesn't get easier just because we get older. Sometimes it gets harder. Now, I would not want anybody to lie, but most of us can find one or two things in our relationships with our children that make me proud, make us proud of them. And it's worth doing. When it comes to saying thank you and I love you, so often it's like stating the obvious. You know, but boy, is it ever worthwhile to say out loud. Mother Teresa once said, there is more hunger for love and appreciation in the world than there is for bread. People think it's not necessary. So often these days, we have, our palliative care service is very active in the intensive care units at Dartmouth Hitchcock. We actually now have a dedicated ICU palliative care team. Not uncommonly, we're in the ICU and we're in the family conference room in the ICU and we're talking about the care of an older person. Perhaps it's the matriarch of a family who's, you know, had a stroke 10 days ago and she's never really quite recovered, and now she's aphasic and she's not particularly responsive, and now we're having the trach and PEG conversation, you know? Does that make sense? Whether to put a tracheostomy in and have a PEG tube, and, you know, maybe she's got a little fever now. This is all really common, almost weekly sort of stuff, happens several times a week. And after we talk about, you know, planning and doing shared decision-making for what treatments would be, I'll often get around to, you know, talking about the four things. And I don't tell people, you know, you need to say these things. It's more, I wonder aloud if it wouldn't have value for them, as it has had for so many families. And as I go through it saying, you know, just saying those please forgive me's, I forgive you's, thank you and I love you. Not uncommonly, one of the adult children, it's often a male, will say, oh, Dr. Byock, you don't have to worry about that. Mom knows how much we love her. She knows how much we appreciate all she's done for us. My response to that these days is, well, good. Then it'll be really easy for you to get in there and say it. No mumbling allowed. Why, you know, it's just worth saying, why wait? This is a good day to say those things to one another. I've even given people some scripts, not because I want to script what they say. And the four things don't have to be said perfectly, you know. You can obviously use your own words, your emotions. But it often helps because people often can't find the words. So things like, you know, Dad, I can never thank you enough for all you've done for me over these years, all you've given me. Mom, you've always been there for me. You gave me life. You were my best friend. Thank you with all my heart. To my, you know, to a spouse or life partner, thank you for all of your love. Thank you for putting up with me. This is one place where being redundant is actually a virtue. Are words really necessary, I'm asked? Well, yeah, or I wouldn't have written a damn book. But of course it isn't. In one sense they are, and in the other sense they aren't. It's the feelings that words convey that are really essential. While I was writing this book, a friend, I was at the University of Montana, and a friend who is a classics teacher at the University of Montana, I call him Gunther in the book, but it's not his real name. He came over to my office, made an appointment, and said, Ira, I need to see you because my father is getting old, and he's getting frail, and his mind is intact, but we're having to, you know, my wife Sally and I are having to go to Minnesota, which is about 1,200 miles away, and move Dad from the house that I grew up in to a nursing facility or some assisted living facility because he just can't care for himself, and he's widowed. My mom died a number of years ago. And I want to do this with as much planning as we can. So, you know, he came in and we sat down and talked. And Sally came with him. Sally, Gunther is a Scandinavian descent. A lot of Scandinavians live in Minnesota. And Sally is Italian-American. Very different. But Gunther said, you know, what do we do? So we went through advanced directives and writing down, you know, what you think you would want towards the end of life for medical treatment and the like, and how to choose a good nursing home and what to look for and when to look for hospice care and how to distinguish good hospice care from mediocre hospice care and on and on and on. And then, of course, I got around to talking about saying the four things that matter most. And I said this to him, and he looked at me with mock horror, and he said, but Ira, what if you're Lutheran? I said, what? And Sally said, you won't believe us. I said, well, what do you mean? Don't you folks say I love you? He says, well, we write it on birthday cards and Christmas cards. Do you hug? He says, well, you know, when we come to visit for Christmas, we may hug at the door, but that's about it. And Sally, who's, you know, Italian-American, very emotive, said, Ira, he's been in recovery for years. I mean, I've been working on him. You know, Gunther will give kisses and stuff, but his parents, you know, they're not so much. So we had this conversation, and I'm telling you the story because about 2 weeks later, Yvonne and I are in our kitchen, and the phone rings in the evening, about dinner time, and it's Gunther. And he's in Minnesota, and he says, Ira, I got to tell you this story. He says, we've been out here, Sally and I have been out here for about 4 days, and we found this wonderful assisted living community for Dad to live in, and it has graded, you know, services so that he gets, you know, more frail, they'll ramp up services, and there's even a skilled nursing facility and a hospice-like center, and it's going to be great. So we've moved Dad to the center. And we went over and saw him 2 days ago in the morning. And Ira, he looked up at me and he said, "Gunther, would you shave me? I think I need to be shaved." Ira, the nurse's aides have been shaving my dad every day. He didn't need to be shaved. And my dad isn't demented. He has his wits about him. And for a moment, I didn't know what to say. And then I flashed back to the conversation we had in your office 2 weeks ago. And I realized my father wasn't asking to be shaved. He was asking to be touched. So we raced back to the house and got his old shaving brush and cup. And I created hot towels with the nursing aide's help at the nursing home. And I swaddled him up in hot towels. And then I shaved him. And every day since, I've been shaving him in the morning. And he said, "I got chills when I realized that I was recreating in reverse a scene that happened in my bathroom in the house I grew up in years ago when I was like 13 or 14, when my father stood behind me and showed me how to shave my neck. And now I was doing it for my father." So the words didn't matter, but the sentiment behind them did. Mortality will teach us a lot about life if we let it. It even teaches us that life is inherently spiritual, not necessarily religious, but spiritual. I met an old gentleman, a farmer from Vermont. They talk like that there. Mr. Grady. Mr. Grady had cancer. I met him in clinic. And I ask him, as I ask everybody, "Mr. Grady, are you a spiritual person? You consider yourself a spiritual person?" He says, "Not me." You know? I said, "Do you have a sense of where we go after we leave this life?" He said, "Yep. The worms go in, the worms go out." I said, you know, I was half prepared because of his demeanor and how he looked. I said, "Mr. Grady, do you have a sense of where the worms will go in and out of your bones?" He said, "Oh yeah, Dr. Byock. We have a plot in our farm up in Thetford, and we Gradys have been buried there for years, centuries really. I'll be there. My children and their children, they'll probably be there too." Very interesting. Mr. Grady doesn't believe in God, doesn't go to church, doesn't pray, but he has a visceral connection to a family which preceded him for generations and will follow him for generations to come, and a connection to the earth, to the land. If that connection to something larger than ourselves isn't spiritual, well, I don't know what to call it. I'm not forcing him to call it spiritual, but I don't know what better term to use. Indeed, the confrontation with death lays bare the spiritual core of the human condition. Human spirituality, for me, as I understand it, arises in response to the at once awe-inspiring and terrifying mystery of life and the universe. We reflexively seek to make meaning of our experience in the world and to strengthen our connections to something larger than ourselves, sometimes merely to our families who will live on for generations to come, or to nature. Lastly, isn't it remarkable that standing so close to death, when people are comfortable, when we're caring for them in ways in which they know they will be well cared for and they will not need to fear suffering as they die, when they know that we will not allow their families to carry too heavy a burden, that often what we observe can only be termed a sense of celebration. Indeed, people who are dying don't take things for granted. But when there is nothing left undone or unsaid between two people who love one another, simply the fact of being in one's presence takes on a sense of celebration. It may be sitting on a porch watching a rainstorm, watching a ball game on the TV, taking a drive, you know, sitting by the beach, just being present with one another, a cup of tea. There is this sense of gratitude and joy that emerges. That's why I do this work. It's not necessary to be dying to have the benefits of having said these four things to one another, to having nothing left unsaid. What I have found, what I've learned in the work that I've done and how it's affected my personal life, is that when there's nothing left unsaid, my relationships with other people have a sense of celebration, of joy. And that, I know from others, is available to all of us on any given day. The most robust response to the fact of mortality, to the fact that we are going to lose each and every person we love, that I know of, is to love one another. Love of people in the face of death is an almost defiant act. It is saying to the force majeure, we matter to one another. People often tell me that their serious diagnosis has forced them to take a hard look at the things that take their time and energy and forced them or gave them the opportunity to reprioritize life. Indeed, the real world is a difficult, harsh place, but even in this cold, hard world, miracles are possible. Small miracles, at least, are possible. We can't make them happen, but we can invite them into our lives. Healing is possible. The truth is that no one needs to wait till they or someone they love is dying to mend and tend and nurture the relationships that really matter most. Healing is possible. Feeling whole is possible. It is possible, even in the face of death, for people to honor, celebrate, and be joyful one to another. That's what those of us who do this work have to give to the rest of society. I want to recruit all of you to tell your stories, because society needs to expand the realm of imagination of what's possible. You know, society, all of our cultures, are swimming in a sea of misery these days. And the response is not more antidepressants, not even new generations of antidepressants. It's not going to be found in the DSM-5. We have met the response. We have met the solution. It's us. By celebrating all of life, by being joyful in the face of reality, by honoring the relationships that matter most, we can reinfuse a sense of health and wholeness and make it possible for people to live fully and indeed to die well. My use of that term, dying well, is indeed the highest health outcome. Because when you hear that term, dying well, when you first hear it, well sounds like an adverb that modifies the process or the experience of dying. But more profoundly, it's an adjective describing the person who is dying. Can you be well during the time of life we would consider you to be dying? Well, of course you can. We're more than our bodies. We have it within us, part of our human endowment, part of our nature-given, or if you prefer, God-given capacity, is to be well through all of life, even as we leave this life. The fact that we're mortal doesn't mean that we need to be pathologic as we die. In fact, the highest outcome, what I would hope for all of you, is to have a sense of well-being, even as you leave this life. That's our great challenge, all of us, not only in this field, but in our culture. And that is our historic opportunity, to achieve a sense of well-being through the very end of life. That's what I came all the way here to express. Thank you so much for the work you all do in palliative care in Victoria, and thank you so much for allowing me to share my thoughts with you today. Thank you. Thank you very much. Odette, do we have a few minutes to take questions? Questions, comments, concerns, disagreements, anything. Really and truly. Yes. Speak.
Just wait for the...
I'm going to come over here
and
sit
with Robert. Wait for the microphone. Yeah, there we go.
Speaking of forgiveness, would you not start by forgiving yourself first for things that you might be worrying that you've done? Before you could then forgive someone else, would you not start first for yourself?
I think very much so. I think that we have to open our hearts to ourselves. I talk so often these days about and ask people to keep their hearts open, first and foremost to themselves, because we are just human. And this life is hard. And so to keep your heart open allows you, first and foremost, to acknowledge yourself as worthy. And then it's so much easier to keep one's heart open to others. Thank you for that. Yes? Yes. This gentleman's going to give you a microphone.
Is that all right? Cool. My question relates to what you were saying about difficult relationships that we might have had. What might be some of the strategies that we'd use or that you would encourage people to use in situations where it might be too difficult to actually speak to someone or there may not be the opportunity?
Well, if it's really hard and they don't feel able, I'll sit with them for as long as it takes sometimes or refer them to a counselor so that they can work through some of this stuff. I believe in the value of mending and tending relationships, but there's not a timeline here. Unless the person, one or the other people in the relationship is in fact dying and time is short, we may need to, illness opposes its own timeline. But otherwise, they may need to simply sit with and express and explore some of their feelings so that they feel strong enough and confident enough to, in fact, show up, arrive with good intentions, and say these sorts of things.
What if it was, say, in a situation?
What if it was perhaps in a situation where you were working with a patient who didn't have long and did potentially recognise the need to address this, didn't have the opportunity or doesn't have the time necessary to, I guess, do all of that work? What might be some of the steps you would take with them?
So sometimes when things are just feel too hot, where there was abuse in a relationship or I had recently actually counseled a gentleman who years ago had a painful divorce, and his first wife is just not speaking to him, and gets angry and starts yelling at him every time they've interacted. But he very much wants to reach out and to the extent possible, express forgiveness, and to the extent possible, mend and tend this relationship. We sat together, and I helped him write a letter. Because in writing a letter framed around the four things, he could control the message. And he could make sure that he wasn't in the passion of the interaction in real time by phone or in person, wasn't taken off message. Because it's so easy for that to happen. So we did it that way. And that worked out quite well, in fact, because he felt better for having written the letter. And in fact, she was able to respond.
One just here. Yeah. I work closely with people who are living with dementia. And so, of course, you can't wait for the last months, weeks for this sort of work. And I was particularly interested in you saying that this work is important because the last chapters of life can be written. Because we work also with life stories with people. And I guess I just want to focus on the importance of doing this work early in the life-limiting disease of dementia so that people can explore this while they still have the time, while they've still got the capacity to be able to do this work. But I guess it's harder for families because the person's still physically present but cognitively deteriorating at very different rates that we can't determine.
So everybody heard that? It was about working with people with dementia. So I totally agree with what you said. It's a value to do it early, and the diagnosis of dementia should be a clarion call for us to do the work of completing our relationships and to honoring and celebrating people as early as possible. but you don't have to do it just once. And you can, you know, you can pamper people. I'm big into pampering therapy, right? To just, you know, in medical, because medicine is so disease-oriented, we just fix problems and we, you know, we address problems. But there's nothing that I can find in medical ethics or medical therapeutics that disallows pampering people, you know, loving care. So part of this is starting early. The other thing I would say, though, is if you've missed those opportunities, it's still of value to say these things to one another. I tell a story in the book of a good friend of mine and her grandmother. We call her Grandma Grace in the book. It's a real story, which is a surprising, what happens is very surprising because during one of these emotionally difficult times with somebody with pretty moderate, not far advanced, but pretty advanced dementia, Grandma Grace has one of these lucid moments, which is a real phenomenon that is rarely written about because there's no neurologic explanation for it. But every one of us who's spent a lot of time around and cared for people with dementia know that occasionally people have these lucid moments as if they almost step out of their dementia for just a few seconds. And so we don't know how much people with dementia are able to process, but it's okay. These are non-toxic things. One of the reasons that I wrote this book is this is the sort of self-counseling tools that are pretty non-toxic. You know, there's not a lot of toxicity in asking for forgiveness, expressing gratitude and love. As long as it's not done with manipulative intent, these are pretty safe things. And so, you know, I suggest people do it at whatever stage of dementia they can. And early is better, but you know, it's not bad to say it at any time, and often surprisingly worthwhile. Thank you for that comment.
One last one. Yeah, one down here. Yeah.
Sure.
Hi, my name's Judy. I'd just like to ask you how you go about challenging the powers that be to understand the importance of what I refer to as existential growth at the end of life. How have you got over that medical model that as long as the pain's controlled and whatever we're doing, good care? How do you prove that this stuff is worthwhile?
Well, you asked us last question was different. How do you prove it? So
that's a consequence, but you know how.
So,
have
but
you...
it's a good. It was a good second question. artfully snuck in, I thought. I don't. How can I say this? A couple of things. One is, I don't expect all the powers that be to get it. In my country, the medical system is solely focused on treating disease. And we really, you know, while we quest after a patient-centered healthcare system, in America, we have a profit-centered disease treatment system. And it's a good one, and it fights disease. There's nothing wrong with fighting disease. It's just not the whole thing. But I don't necessarily expect everyone to get it. Now, I talk about this. I've given talks like this at medical grand rounds and in many medical centers, and many people do get it, and it sort of resonates on some level with them. But I've gotten over waiting for the powers that be, as you call them, the medical powers, to get this stuff. I don't give them that authority anymore. This is for all of us as a culture to do for ourselves. If we're waiting for the medical system to get it so that we can benefit from this sort of practical wisdom, we'll wait a long time, and it's likely not to happen. But your second question is artful because, you know, what's the benefit of this? Well, I and others are now working on measuring the benefits of this stuff on not only people who are seriously ill, but even more so on those that they leave behind. Their caregivers and those who survive their death. You know, Ron and I were talking before about the problem of grief. Now, grief isn't a diagnosis. It's not an illness, despite what the DSM-5 says. It's
it's part of normal living. It hurts like hell. You know, it's not fun, but it's not pathological. But of course, some grief is. Complicated grief is a serious health problem for those with it. And frankly, collectively, it's a serious public health problem. What I know about complicated grief, well, let me say, grief hurts, but complicated grief is worse. And it's about the would-haves, could-haves, should-haves, what-ifs, the regrets, the recriminations, the missed opportunities. Part of what we're doing using this work and others other like it, using the four things, and it's now being embedded in some standardized therapeutic approaches to the normal work of life completion. We believe that it has ramifications in the emotional well-being of survivors, of those left behind. Less prolonged grief, less complicated grief. And as we're beginning to measure that in survivors who have gone through, whose loved one has gone through the work of life completion, and those compared to those who have not. And early indications are that there's significant differences, that the quality of life of the person who is seriously ill and dying is better through the end of life. There's less anxiety, less depression, you know, but also that the grief experience of their loved ones tends to be less prolonged, less complicated, and sometimes, you know, I get the occasional call or letter from people who've lost a loved one who say, you know, I don't know, maybe I'm in denial, but I feel good. And part of the time, that's because I can tell them there was nothing left unsaid. You know, you took such great care of Joe, and Joe was not only clean and comfortable, he was honored and celebrated. You did so much of this work that, sure, you're sad, but sadness alone, in fact, is the cost of loving someone. And it's not an illness. But but again, we've prevented the complicated grief. That can be measured, and we're beginning to do this. Harvey Chochnoff's dignity therapy, he's beginning to, which is very much this work of life completion. Karen Steinhauser's outlook therapy, again, has embedded some of these four things within it. And we're beginning to attempt to embed this in normal palliative care and supportive care of people through the end of life and measure the outcomes. You're a wonderful audience. Thank you so very, very much for coming and participating today.
Ira, on behalf of all of us, thank you so much. You've really outlined how well-being can be part of death and dying, not only for those dying, but for those who go on living. So I think that's just so valuable. And this is a little gesture for you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope everybody will stay on for afternoon tea. Ira's available to talk to you, to sign books. I want to thank again Ultra Feedback, but also invite you to support the Australian Palliative Link International. Its activities include fundraising and volunteering to support the development of palliative care in the Asia-Pacific region, which would be very interesting in terms of probably better cultural approaches, actually, to death and dying that Western cultures could learn from. Please come and have a cup of tea and enjoy.
Thank you, Rhonda, very much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for being part of this.